has been a missionary to the continent of Africa for the last 21 years. At this past general conference in the States, he was reappointed to the country of the Philippines. And so he's going to be joining this side of the world and working in the Philippines. And I know that he's going to be blessed there. But my brother was always a great, great source of strength to me, and a great inspiration, and he was a great stabilizer in my life. He started preaching the gospel at the age of 12, and at the age of 14, he started evangelizing and traveling. Well, I was 12, he was 14, and he took me along with him. And so every summer when school would be out, it's a little different in our part of the world than here, but school would end at the end of May, and then we would have 3 months in the summer, and school would pick up in late August or early September. And he and I would travel all summer long. And we, neither one of us were old enough to drive a car. So mom and dad, on the day, usually after school, they would take us down to the bus station. And they would put us on a bus. And we'd have our suitcases and our instruments and all. And away we would go. And we would have revivals. Usually we would get maybe a Monday night off. But we would end a revival somewhere on a Sunday night. And then a pastor would come and pick us up and drive us to his church, and we would start there on Tuesday night. And I did this all through my teenage years. I never preached during those years. My brother was the preacher. And when I graduated from high school, of course, he went off to Bible college. And during all that time, he married. And when he married, I got replaced. Thus ended my evangelistic tenure for a while. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I knew I loved the Lord. I had had the Holy Ghost since I was 9. Serving the Lord was never for sale with me. I was going to serve the Lord no matter what I did.
Amen.
And so I entered university in Memphis, Tennessee, where I grew up. And my thought was that I would at some point marry, I would graduate from college, and I would get in the home church that I'd grown up in and just be the best saint that I knew how to be. That was my thought. And I loved to sing and I loved to play. I was involved. We had a wonderful music program in the church. And in my second year of college, I received a phone call with an invitation to join the church staff in Nashville, Tennessee. It was a major decision for me because I was in college. But after talking with my parents and praying, I decided to try this and to go and become the music director for the church there. I told them I would do it for 6 months and see how it worked. And if I wasn't happy, then I would go back and pick up my college classes in the fall. Well, the 6 months turned into 2 years, and I enjoyed. I had the best time. I loved that church. I tell you, I just love the people of God. I've always said this. Brother Robert Fuller, my wonderful friend that I'm so privileged to be his pastor, is traveling with me on this trip. He's heard me say this many, many times. But for me as a preacher, the best thing that I know to do when things are going rough, and you know what? Sometimes as a pastor, you feel like the church is just coming unraveled. You get so focused on a few problems. You think everything's coming apart. And you wonder if God even knows where you are. The best thing that I've ever been able to do is get to a church service and get with the people of God. I'm telling you, your worship, listening to saints sing, and listen to them lift up the name of Jesus. It's a reassurance to me. I watch in my home, in my local church that I'm so privileged to pastor. I watch precious saints of God who walk into those doors and they lift their voice. They're not aware of all the problems that I've been dealing with, and found out the problem is really not all that big compared to the church family. And it's just good for me to get with the family. Hallelujah. Amen. This is why it's good for you to come to conference. Sometimes you may be in a much smaller congregation, and you might think sometimes that it can be pretty lonely. But when you get in a large gathering and you find out there are others that believe this precious truth and love it with all of their hearts, it's a strength to you to be in the family of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. After 2 years in Nashville, I was feeling the call to enter the ministry. And that was a hard thing for me because my father had been a preacher, my brother had been a preacher, and I didn't want to just be another preacher. I didn't want to be a preacher just because they had been preachers. When we'd be in revivals, people would come up and they'd say, "And when are you going to start preaching?" And I'd say, "I'm not a preacher. I'm not a preacher. I just sing." And I'd hear that. "When are you going to start preaching?" So it was a major struggle with me to finally acknowledge that God had called me to preach the gospel. God put a wonderful elder minister in my life by the name of Norman Pasley from Cincinnati, Ohio. Brother Pasley, God put us together. And when I poured my heart out to him and talked to him about how I was feeling, and I told him, I called him after a series of fasting, and I called him and I said, "Brother Pasley, I believe God has called me to preach. I don't know what to do, but I believe God has called me to preach." And he said, "Well, if God's called you to preach, I want you to preach your first sermon in my church." And so I went to Cincinnati to preach a revival. He scheduled me for 1 week. 1 week. And I had never preached before. I resigned Nashville and I went on the evangelistic field and had never preached a sermon. And I was a full-time evangelist. Scared to death. The first sermon I ever preached was entitled "The Real Old Time Pentecost." And would anybody have any idea where I took my text? Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4 and verse 38. 6 people got the Holy Ghost, 4 were baptized, and I was in shock. Eight weeks later, we closed that revival. And I'm going to confess something to you. I was glad to close that revival. Every night was a brand new sermon. And I thought, there can't be anything left to preach. I have preached everything in 8 weeks in the Bible. But I'm telling you, there has never been anything like getting among the people of God to help me get my bearing straight. When I've questioned, is it worth all sometimes that you struggle with to do right? Just get me to the church. Get me with the people of God who love this blessed truth and are so thankful for what God has done in their life. Hallelujah. Amen. That's why I'm going to preach to you tonight about a very simple, basic truth. There's power in the blood. There's power in the blood. Hallelujah. I keep looking at these. Amen. Isn't that interesting? That's always been one of the neatest little things. A lot of things have been invented, but nothing will fascinate me ever any more than this does. You pull one of those out, another one, and another one is right there. It's amazing. Absolutely amazing. Hallelujah. Amen. Every time that I buy a box of tissue, I think about God's bountiful supply. Amen. Hallelujah. I do. Praise God. Amen. Well, why don't you sing a little bit of this old song with me? I was going somewhere with all my story a little bit ago that while I love, I'm telling you, I just feast on this singing. It just blesses me. But I got on a little kick about a year and a half ago trying to pull up the old songs. Just the old songs. We have prayer meeting every Monday night at home, and every Monday night I try to come up with an old song that they've never heard. And sometimes I get one that they all don't know it, and most of the time somebody in the group's heard about every song. But I want you to follow me with this. Brother Jonathan's going to help me here. Hallelujah. Amen. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. I don't know if I can remember all of this verse, but we're going to try it. And when I don't know the words, I hum. How many of you can hum? This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What is the next? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, sing the chorus. Oh, think about what you're singing. That makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. One more time, the chorus. That makes me white. Oh, no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. I was in prayer asking the Lord a couple of years ago. You may be seated. I was asking the Lord, as every pastor does, for revival. Oh God, I want revival. Lord, we've built this building. We can put a lot of people in this building. I want to see this building full. God, I want revival. Whatever we got to do, give us revival. And I, the Lord spoke to my heart. And he told me something that I will never get away from. He said, I'm going to give you your revival. But it's going to be a mess. That's what he told me. I'm going to give you your revival, but it's going to be a mess. Do you know I can't find any good sinners to preach to? They're all messed up. Matter of fact, the problem with a sinner is so severe, it can't be fixed. They have to be born again. Amen. Amen. You can't fix sin. You can't improve. You can't make it better. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. You just got to start up. Man has a radical problem, and radical problems require radical solutions. And what a radical solution. The solution to a man's problem with sin is he must be born again. We can't fix it. We just got to start all over. Amen. Amen. Brother Jonathan, four flats. Are you in or A? You like A. Do A.
We do an A.
Do whatever you want to do. Amen. You don't have to play in A flat. I just like A flat, but you play in A. Play in G for Jesus. That's good. G for Jesus. That's a good key. Amen. Hallelujah. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's one wonderful power in the blood. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Oh, there is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. The Lamb. I want you to thank God that there's power in the blood right now. We're going to preach about it a little bit. There's power in the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's not a sin that the blood cannot cover. Thank God for power in the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. If you will turn in your Bibles to the book of 1 John, chapter 1. I'm going to read verses 5, 6, and 7. Amen. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Wow. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanseth us from all sin. There's power in the blood. Hallelujah. Why don't you put your Bibles down and let's clap our hands and lift our voice and make a joyful noise to the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Amen. One of our young ministers called one of our elders and asked this question of this elder minister. How do I get more power? A young preacher. How do I get more power? And without hesitation, the old minister said to him, you have to have a fresh revelation of the blood. Amen. Amen. You have to have a fresh revelation of the blood. Amen. He went on to tell that young preacher that God does not have to be begged nor made to feel obligated. He has provided power through the blood. Power through the blood. Hallelujah. So I want to just bring to you a wonderful thought tonight that has blessed my soul. And that is an understanding that there is power in the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. If you know anything about our history as a church, you will know that the early church depended so very much on the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. They depended on it. Hallelujah. Amen. And it was very much a part of everything that we did. I remember going to church as a child and hearing about the blood. Maybe not profound messages, but just the message, the solidness, the core of our belief being reiterated over and over and over. The name of Jesus and the power of the blood always being preached. Hallelujah. And it would have an incredible effect on the altar. I'm going to tell you the one thing that I appreciate about you as a church that I have observed 6 years ago when I was here last night, and I've watched it through today. Amen. I love the way you pray and worship, and I love the way you gather around the altar. I want to thank you for that. Amen. I remember a time when there was less emphasis on any personality that might be bringing the word, and the thought in the congregation was, when you get to the altar after the word has been preached, if you go to the altar, amen, God is going to meet your need. Hallelujah. You know what? If we can just get hungry after a move of God and what the power of the presence of God can do among us, amen, we won't be worried about the personality in the pulpit. If you get worried about the personality, amen, then if your preacher doesn't preach, then you didn't enjoy yourself. You left a little sad that you even wasted your time coming to church. But if you fall in love with Jesus Christ, amen, if somebody stands up and says, thus saith the word of the Lord, hallelujah, amen, something's going to happen around the altar as a result of the preached word of God. Amen. Amen. There's power in the blood. Amen. Anyone who would remember the name Andrew Urshan. This was the father of our general superintendent, Brother Nathaniel Urshan, Brother A.D. Urshan. Anybody who knew him said that there were two things that he always preached in every message he ever preached. And that was, he preached on the blood and he preached on the name of Jesus. It didn't matter what else he was preaching about. He was going to get around to the blood and to the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. These two things are the most powerful elements in the gospel. The blood of Jesus and the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Now, I know that I'm in Australia, but I don't think you're a whole lot different than we are. Amen. Do you folks plead the blood? Plead the blood? Amen. Back where I'm from, they plead the blood a lot. Hallelujah. Amen. And that's a powerful thing to do. I remember hearing Sister Vesta Mangan preach one time, and she was preaching on the blood, and she talked about pleading the blood. Amen. And ever since then, I've watched her in church services. And she'll be on the platform, and she'll be walking and pacing a little bit, and she'll sling that arm out there. She doesn't have a microphone, and you can't hear her because she's not the speaker. She's just on the platform. But she explained in the message one time, she said, "I'm pleading the blood. I'm pleading the blood. I plead the blood of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus over you." Hallelujah. Amen. It'd be amazing what would happen if all of us would just plead the blood over everything that's important to us. Hallelujah. Amen. You ought to get up every morning in your house and plead the blood over your home. Amen. Amen. Before your children go to school, plead the blood over them. Hallelujah. When you walk into the house of God, plead the blood over the pulpit. Plead the blood over the congregation. Hallelujah. Amen. I've got a lot of messages that I've preached on the blood. I've got a lot of things that I understand about the blood. And I'm going to tell you that wherever you put the blood, it is off limits to the devil from that point. He has no legal right where the blood has been applied. Hallelujah. Amen. You need to plead the blood. When your pastor gets up to preach, plead the blood over him. Hallelujah. Amen. And let me tell you, when a sinner makes his way to the altar, you ought to begin to plead the blood. Plead the blood. Hallelujah. Because there's power in the blood of Jesus Christ over every sin, over everything that has gone on in that sinner's life. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. A lot of wonderful songs have been written about the blood. Hallelujah. You see, God established a blood consciousness in man. Way back in the beginning, Adam and Eve stood by and they watched as God slew an animal. And it impressed them. It made an impression upon them. And it has made an impression upon every child since. Blood is so important. Amen. Amen. When you talk about blood, there is an innate feeling that takes place. Even areas of the world where the message of this gospel has not been preached, there have been discoveries of people that have a conscience about some spiritual being, some power bigger than they are. And so they create a religious mind and they try to somehow please their God. Amen. And in many cases, blood is involved in that. Many times, blood is involved. I was in the country of Madagascar preaching a conference there some years ago, and they took me to the mountain of the burial place of the kings of Madagascar. And on that mountain, there was a resident witch doctor that lived there. I saw him. I didn't interact with him. I didn't talk with him. But they showed me these altars, and you could see the stain of blood upon these stones and rocks where people would bring sacrifices to that mountain to sacrifice. And there was the requirement of blood involved in that. Amen. Blood and the shedding of blood has always been a fixed thing in man's mind. Amen. Way back in ancient Athens, when a plague would strike a city, a man would be stoned as a consequence. There had to be the shedding of blood. In Persia, amen, in a battle, the first captain captive of any battle was sacrificed to their gods. In Egypt, there was a minimum of 3 men sacrificed every day. The requirement of blood. Amen. And on in different parts of the world, there has been this involvement of blood. Amen. The blood is a source of our protection. Hallelujah. Amen. We sometimes don't really pause and think about what the blood of Jesus really means to us. Blood is very much a part of our experience with God. Amen. We don't bring sacrifices today. Amen. It is no longer required by the word of the Lord. When Jesus Christ died on Calvary, amen, he became the one necessary sacrifice for all mankind. Hallelujah. Amen. No longer do we have to bring a lamb or turtle doves or anything to appease God. Amen. Appeasement has already been made at Calvary. Hallelujah. I am so thankful tonight, amen, that there was one who qualified to become the sacrifice for all mankind. God became a man, robed himself in flesh, and lived among us. Amen. And then he was crucified, and he died, and his blood was shed. Amen. When you go back to the Exodus in the history of Israel, amen, amen, you know the story of the plagues that came and death came to the land of Egypt, amen. And there was an antidote that was to be applied to Israel, and that antidote was blood, amen, amen. The only antidote that would protect the people of God in that situation was blood applied to their homes. Amen. We live in a similar world today. Amen. We live in a world of suicide. We live in a world of scandal. We live in a world of violence. We live in a world of mass murder. We live in a world of sex abuse. We live in a world that is ungodly and does not care, seemingly, to follow God in any way. Amen. I really believe the scripture. And I've watched in these recent years at some of the terrible things that have happened in our world, in the weather and in the elements. Amen. And people have tried to understand. Some people have tried to say that it is the judgment of God. I don't believe that it's the judgment of God. I believe that it is exactly what Jesus said. Amen. When people were praising him and there was an effort to try to get people to be quiet, and Jesus said, if these don't praise me, the rocks are going to cry out. Amen. Now, you may disagree with me on my theology on this, but I'm going to tell you, amen, that I think that what we are seeing in this world could be very easily settled down to a sense of normalcy if man would recognize God and would worship him and praise him. I think this earth is doing what you and I are supposed to do. Amen. The elements are simply expressing themselves and recognizing and acknowledging that God is all in all and that he is in control. Amen. I believe this. I believe that if we would praise him, I believe the earth would remain calm and quiet. But by men's refusal to acknowledge who God is, amen, the earth is going to respond. The earth is going to show the magnificence of God. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We need the blood of Jesus just as much as Israel needed the blood of Jesus applied in that night of the Exodus. Amen. We need to apply the blood to our homes and to our lives. Hallelujah. Amen. There are things that happen. And have you ever been driving your car and there be some what looked to be an imminent accident about to take place, and you just simply called on the name of Jesus, and you don't know how it happened, you don't know how you avoided the accident, but suddenly everything was corrected, amen, and you just sit there for a moment and thank God that you are not hurt, amen. I'm telling you, the blood is active in our life if we apply it and if we recognize it and use it. Hallelujah. You need to plead the blood all the time. Amen. There is a word that came into our vocabulary some years ago. I'm not exactly sure when it came, but it happened. I was told that it happened back during times of some wars years ago of our country. We fought what we call the Korean War and the Vietnam War, and there was a word called appeasement that entered into our language, pretty common. Amen. And the ideal was is that we would try some strategy of appeasement. We would try to get along. We would try to somehow or another sit down and bargain. Appeasement means to give in. But let me tell you something. Get this in your mind. Above everything else, you do not appease sin and evil. You do not give in to it. You take a stand against it in the name of the Lord. Take a stand against it. Stand for right. Amen. No matter what it may cost you, stand for right. Amen. Let me tell you, pastor, something. God wants to give your church the greatest revival that you have ever seen. But I'm going to tell you that when your revival starts, it's going to be a messy thing. People are going to come to your altars and their lives are going to be in upheaval. They're going to be in disarray. And there's not going to seem to be a lot of solution. Amen. Amen. I've been amazed at people sometimes who have walked through our doors and they have come to the altar. And they have received the Holy Ghost, and we have baptized them in Jesus' name, and they sit down and they want to start living for God. They want their life ordered after the right things of God. Amen. And when they start telling me their problems and the situations in their lives and in their homes, amen, my heart gets heavy. Amen. I think, dear God, this is indeed a mess. Anybody, if anybody can fix this, it's going to have to be you, Lord. I don't have an answer. I don't have a solution. Amen. And so I look at them, and in many cases, the only hope that I can give them is I tell you what we're going to do. We're going to pray. Amen. But I am not telling you that as a cop out. I'm telling you that that's the best thing that we can do. And if we will pray, God has promised that He will come on the scene. And God has promised to give you the victory if you will pray and if you will be faithful to Him. Amen. And so we began by pleading the blood, because there's power in the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. The lamb in Israel's day was the antidote for the death angel. Amen. And I'm going to tell you, you can't improve on that prescription. Amen. The blood that came from that lamb, amen, that was what was to be applied to the door. Hallelujah. The lamb was the antidote then, and there is a lamb that was slain at Calvary that is an antidote for all of us now. Hallelujah. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, amen. The Bible says in verses 23, but we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness, but unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Amen. You cannot improve upon the prescription that the Bible gives us as an antidote for sin. Paul said, amen, that it is a stumbling block to some, amen, but to us who believe, believe it is the power of God. Hallelujah. I find it interesting in studying the Exodus of Egypt for Israel. Amen. Israel was not asked to understand how this works. Amen. Somebody wants to know, how does it work? Amen. You don't have to understand how it works. Amen. I want to tell you it works. Hallelujah. Amen. When they said, all right, what you got to do? You got to take a lamb and you got to kill that lamb. You collect the blood. Amen. You eat the lamb. You take the blood from that lamb and from that sacrifice and you put the blood over the doorpost of your house. Amen. There's bound to have been some intellect in the bunch that wanted to try to figure out how that works, but they didn't have time for all of that. Amen. Just do it. Just obey and believe, and if you'll put the blood over your house, amen, you'll be safe from the plague that is about to come. Hallelujah. Amen. My friend, the blood will mark you. It will mark you distinctly. Amen. The blood has a purpose. It has a function. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm not a doctor, and I don't understand a lot of the medical side of this, but I am told that the blood is made of red disc and white cells. Red disc and white cells. Amen. The red are smooth, shiny disc. And the white cells have no specific shape. The white cells are the armed warriors of the body. Amen. They kind of free float. But when danger comes, the white cells go directly to the crisis area. And the white cells assume the shape of the invader. They assume the shape of the enemy and they cover the enemy and they explode. There are, I am told, 50 billion with a B. 50 billion of these white cells in your body. And they are backed up with a force of 100 times that large in the bone marrow. The body is equipped to care for itself. Amen. The blood has so much to fight against. It has so much to try to protect the body from. There are 50,000 germs on the rim of a glass. There are 1 billion germs in a half teaspoon of saliva. There are 5 million germs. Every time you wash your hands, you wash away 5 million germs. Amen. Amen. I'm telling you that I am full of the Holy Ghost, and the blood of Jesus is covering my life, and I am healthy today. Because of the blood. I am healthy today because of the blood. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. There was no other antidote for Israel. Hallelujah. The instruction was, you get the blood on your house. Get the blood on your house. Except for the blood, there is no hope. Amen. There is a death angel that's coming to Egypt tonight. Amen. And everywhere he sees the blood, he's going to pass over that house. Amen. I don't know about you, but I would think that every father in Israel that night did not sleep very well. Amen. I wouldn't have slept very well. I would think they would have given specific instruction to their children that night. Whatever you do, don't you leave this house for anything. Amen. Junior, you've been known to slip out of the window and run down to the convenience store. Don't you do that tonight, son. Amen. You stay in this house. Amen. Something's about to happen in Egypt. Amen. And we are the chosen people of God. Amen. We got our bags packed. We're getting ready to leave here. Amen. But there's a death angel that's going to visit this land tonight. Amen. And we've got to stay under the blood. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. There needs to be an effort on the part of the Australian church. Amen. To get everything dear to you. Every family member. Amen. You may have backsliders in your family. You may have some that have never cared for this gospel. Amen. But don't you give up on them. Amen. You plead the blood of Jesus over their life. Hallelujah. You don't ever quit. Amen. Because when the death angel passes over, wherever he sees the blood, he will pass over them. Hallelujah. Amen. He will pass over them in Jesus' name. Oh my. Hallelujah. Amen. The blood of Jesus is working for us right now. Working for us right now. Amen. Bishop G.T. Haywood, a minister of years gone by in the city of Indianapolis, Indiana, where he pastored. Amen. He wrote a song that many of us have sung through the years. I see a crimson stream of blood. Hallelujah. Amen. He wrote that song after spending time in prayer and fasting. God gave him a new revelation of the power of the blood. Hallelujah. One verse of that song says, when gloom and sadness whisper, you've sinned, there's no need to pray. Have any of you ever been there? Have you messed up? Have you made a mistake? And the devil perches himself right on your shoulder and he talks right in your ear and he says, oh, you really messed up this time. There's no need for you to pray. There's no need for you to bother God. You're such a miserable failure. Amen. The second part of that verse says, I turn away to Jesus and he tells me to say, I see a crimson stream of blood. It flows from Calvary. Its waves, which reach the throne of God, are sweeping over me. Hallelujah. Ah. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Don't you ever give up on the power of the blood. Hallelujah. Amen. I have spent countless hours in prayer, pacing in the prayer room, sometimes in the sanctuary, sometimes in my office. I have walked. I have laid on the floor. I have wrestled back and forth. Amen. Sometimes I've got young people that aren't behaving themselves and they're not doing right. Amen. They come from good Holy Ghost filled families, and I don't know what gets in their mind, but they just decide they don't want to do right. Amen. I've gone to prayer, and I don't ever pray to the devil, but I talk to him when I'm praying sometimes, because I know he's there. He don't miss a church service in my church. He don't miss a prayer meeting I go to. He's always there, and he's interrupting me sometimes when I'm praying, so I sometimes just stop and talk to him just a minute. Amen. And I've told him, Satan, let me tell you something. I know some things about you. Amen. And I know some things about this church. Number one, you are a liar. You are the father of lies. Amen. And you may think you're going to get this young person, but I got news for you. I'm pleading the blood. I'm pleading the blood. You're going to have to back off. You can't have this young person. You can't have this family. You can't have anybody in this church. Amen. I'm pleading the blood. I'm putting the blood over their soul. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ is going to cover them and it's going to keep them. Something's going to happen in their spirit. They're going to be stirred. They're going to be awakened because the blood never loses its power. You know what? Some of us in the church need to wake up and realize that this old ship of Zion is not a cruise ship. It's a battleship. And we're in a war. We need to make up our mind, amen, that we're going to fight the good fight of faith every day. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. The devil's tried direct confrontation. That hadn't worked with me. So he's tried to be my friend. He's tried to be my buddy. That don't work either. Because the first thing I tell him this. Every time he interrupts me and I got to address him, I say, Satan, let me tell you what I know about you. You're a liar. So there ain't nothing You're the father of lies. There ain't nothing that you're going to say to me that I'm going to believe. If you tell me that you can offer something equal for people that this salvation from Calvary gives them, I'm telling you right now, you're a liar. You don't know what you're talking about. If you're going to tell me that you're going to be kind and you're going to be good and it's going to be a benefit to someone to follow you and to walk away from Calvary, I'm telling you, I know you are a liar. You don't know how to tell the truth. Amen. Can I tell you right now that the devil does not have any legal right wherever you put the blood? That's why I keep my house full of the blood. I keep my marriage full of the blood. I keep my boys full of the blood. I keep my church full of the blood. Amen. I do not want the devil to be able to come in and take over and wreak havoc in my church. I want there to be a revival. Hallelujah. I don't care how messy. Give me every sinner I can get. I don't care about their background. I don't care about their luggage. All the trash they bring in. Hallelujah. The blood has red cells and white cells. Amen. The blood will cleanse. The blood will purify. It doesn't matter how much junk is in somebody's life. The blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse from all sin and all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God. Hallelujah. I don't care what your problem is tonight, the blood of Jesus can cover it. Do you hear me? Amen. Somebody told me one time, said, oh, said, I only pray about the big stuff. I don't bother God with the little stuff. I'm usually a pretty nice guy. But that sounded so arrogant to me. I looked at him, I said, who do you think you are? The big stuff. The little stuff. I said, I'm going to tell you what. I don't trust the devil with anything. I take everything. Everything. To God in prayer. Everything. Everything. Hallelujah. Amen. Some people are afraid they're going to somehow exhaust God. We say, I don't want to bother him all this little stuff. I don't want to use up all my credits with God on little stuff. Let me tell you something. Don't you worry about God. The blood. The blood will never lose its power. You know, sometimes we get to thinking like, well, I'll tell you what, this is only Thursday, and you know, I don't know if I exhaust everything now, I won't, may not be able to make it till Sunday. Amen. I wouldn't want to exhaust heaven. I wouldn't want heaven to run low. I wouldn't want to find out that there was a bigger crisis coming and I used up all the reserve in heaven on the small. Amen. Don't believe all that trash. Amen. The blood's never going to lose its power, Brother Slack. Amen. There's power in the name of Jesus and there's power in the blood. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you tonight that it flows freely to this service. Amen. This place is covered with the blood of Jesus. And if you want to be the benefactor of it tonight, all you've got to do is step forward. All you got to do is say, God, here I am. I want everything you've got for me. Hallelujah. Amen. Some people think they're a real prize. Well, I tell you what, when God gets me, he's really going to get something. Yeah. It's the same thing I think sometimes. When God gets you, he's really got a mess on his hands. But you know what? It doesn't bother God at all. Amen. He can somehow just reach in and scoop up the blood. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. The blood is an important thing. Hallelujah. The disciples went out one time. Jesus sent them all out, about 70 of them, sent them all out, and he gave them power. And I'm telling you, it must have been an amazing thing. These disciples, for perhaps the first time, went out on their own, and everywhere they went, there were miracles, and there were signs, and there were wonders, and there were devils cast out of people. It was unbelievable. These disciples came back after a period of time. I mean, they were high as a kite on what God was doing with them. Amen. They were ribbing each other. They were laughing. They were slapping each other on the back. Amen. They were talking about the miracle that happened last night. They're talking about the miracle that took place this morning. And they were talking about this and that. And when they got back, they're telling Jesus all about it. And he's standing there listening to them. And then he looks at them when they all finally shut up. And he says, that's all good, because I gave you power to do that. But don't rejoice, because demons are subject to you. He said, rejoice, because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Oh, hallelujah. I feel like talking in tongues a little bit. Amen. Amen. Let me tell you something, folks. Hallelujah. I don't know just how it's going to work. Amen. But there's a record kept of everything we've done since we've been on this earth. But if you've been by Calvary, and if you've taken advantage of the free-flowing blood of Jesus Christ, amen, when he looks at your name is going to be white. There's not going to be any record of sin. There's not. Hallelujah. Amen. That's why the Bible says that the devil is an accuser of the brethren. I have no doubt that the devil has at times gone before God and mentioned some things that you have done. You know what God does? He just goes over to his book and he looks up your name. And he looks there at your name. And there is no record of that. Because of the blood that has blotted that out. Your name is clean. Hallelujah. Your name is clean. Amen. Your name is clean in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hear me tonight. There is power in the blood. Wonder working power in the blood. I don't care what the devil has told you. I don't care what condemnation has come over your mind. Hallelujah. You can walk out of here tonight. Amen. You may have had the Holy Ghost for years, but we all sometimes mess up. We always. I've got to where I pray against every thought, every word, and every action. Every thought, every word, and every action. Anything I've done. Anything I've thought, if there's been an arrogant spirit in me, if I've been prideful, if there's been something that displeases God, I plead the blood. I repent of it. I am sorry for it. I don't want it to be held against me. Amen. I want to repent. I want to be clean. Folks, you're looking at a preacher tonight that has one primary purpose and goal in my life. I intend to make it to heaven. I am going to make it to heaven. It is my life's aim to hear him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen. I don't want there to be a jealous bone in me. I don't want to resent anybody. I want to praise God for the good that is happening in every one of us. Hallelujah. And I rejoice. If God gives you revival that is greater than anything I've ever seen, I want to rejoice with you in that. I don't want to be jealous of you. I don't want to resent you. I don't want to try to undercut what the testimony is of the power of God. I want to praise God because you hear me. Across this land of Australia, there are some pastors sitting in this service tonight. If you could see what God's about to do in your ministry, it would surprise you. It would absolutely take your breath. Amen. Are you ready for the revival that God has said he was going to give you? Amen. Are you willing for the mess that's going to come with it? Hallelujah. God's going to give you what you have been asking for and praying for because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It's going to flow through your city. It's going to shut down down some things in your town that need to be shut down, your church is going to make an impact. Hallelujah. Amen. Do you know that people are going to know who you are? They're going to see you walk down the streets of your town, and they're going to say, that's their people of the name. Amen. They have power with God. Hallelujah. My wife and I were in a restaurant just the week before Christmas, and we had our Christmas service the Sunday before. And there was a pastor in the city, a denominational pastor, and I had met him one time right after we built our church. He came by and looked at it, and so he stared at me and I stared at him, and I finally said, "I know you from somewhere." And he said, "Well, I think I know you from somewhere." And we reintroduced ourselves and realized where we had met. And he asked me, he said, "Have you had your Christmas service yet?" I said, "Oh, yeah." We had our Christmas service. I said, "We had church." He said, "I just want to ask you something." He said, "Do Pentecostal people still act like Pentecostal people?" I said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "Don't ever change." He said, "Our city needs you." This is a preacher that doesn't even preach what we preach. He's telling me not to ever change. I'd be a fool to try to become like him. Can witness like Pentecostal people. He said, "There's nobody who looks like Pentecostal people." He said, "There's no preachers that can preach like Pentecostal people." Amen. I told him, I said, "I need to record this." And I told him, I said, "You need to become a Pentecostal preacher." Amen. We anoint with oil in our church. I have probably 7 or 8 bottles of oil that I keep up on the pulpit. We have a lot of preachers, and when we pray for the sick. A few weeks ago, we had an old-fashioned healing line. Like to wore me out. The line, I didn't think it would ever end. It went on and on and on. An old-fashioned healing line. And our preachers just prayed themselves silly. But some years ago, we had a lady that began to visit us from a denominational church. She would come, and she would notice that we would anoint and pray for the sick in our services. And she was a member of a very starchy, traditional church that did not believe in modern-day miracles or healing of any of that sort. And she had a dear friend in her church that came down with cancer. And so she went to the elders of her church and she said, "I want my friend," whoever this member of their church was, "I want her to be anointed with oil and prayed for." The elders kind of teamed up and supported one another, and they said, "We don't believe in doing that here." She said, "If you don't do it, I'm taking her to Emmanuel Pentecostal Church. Because they've got not only the practice of anointing with oil, but they've got people sitting in their pews that have been healed of cancer and been healed of all manner of disease. And if you're not willing to pray for them, I'm going to take her somewhere where the blood will have its way, where the blood will work." This church had a meeting of its elders, and they did a little research in the scripture and found out that it was a practice of the early church that the book of James talks about anointing with oil. And so in the next service, in order to try to keep this little woman from coming to the Pentecostal church, they got up and said, "We're going to do something that we have never done before. We have designated a room down the hall off to the right. And if you want to be anointed with oil, we're not going to do that here in the sanctuary. But if you want to be anointed with oil, you go down to that room and we've got some elders down there that will anoint you with oil." Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. We don't have a designated room for that. We got 12 and a half acres of land designated for that. We'll slap you upside the head with oil. Hallelujah. We'll plead the blood of Jesus over every disease, over every sick thing in your brain. Amen. Whatever you've got in your heart that's not right, I believe the blood of Jesus can fix it. I believe the blood is able to break it. Do you hear me right now? There may be somebody in this house right now that is all bound up with spiritual bondage. In the name of Jesus, by the power of this word, I plead the blood of Jesus over you right now. I rebuke that bondage. I command you to be set free by the power of the word. Hallelujah. I plead the blood. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Amen. I feel this to be a night of deliverance. I think God wants to set some people free. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me tell you something. Just living life, we can get kind of a warped sense of value sometime. Amen. Just trying to get through the pressures of life, we can forget some things. That's why we have to visit the altar pretty often. That's why we need to pray through every once in a while. Amen. Brother Robert Fuller sitting here tonight, one of the greatest men that I ever had the pleasure of pastoring was his uncle. Amen. And his uncle was a wonderful, wonderful member of our church. And he died when he was quite elderly, and he'd had the Holy Ghost for many years. And this was his testimony. He said when he was a young boy, when he received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, he said there were four other people seeking the Holy Ghost in that service, a total of five. He said, I got the Holy Ghost first. All right, there we go. Amen. I'm glad that I said that with the mic off. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. He said, four others were seeking the Holy Ghost. He said, I got the Holy Ghost first that night. He said, and then every one of them got the Holy Ghost. And he said, every time one of them got the Holy Ghost, I got it all over again. He said, the night I got the Holy Ghost, I got the Holy Ghost five times. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Let me tell you something. If it's been a long time since you've had spoken tongues, if it's been a long time since you've been drunk in the Spirit, if it's been a long time since you have felt the freedom and the liberty to worship God, amen, you don't need to put it off any longer. Amen. You need to make an effort tonight to get free in the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, I'm pleading the blood over your mind right now. Amen. I'm going where you may not want anybody to go. Hallelujah. Those things that you have been fighting, I'm telling you to bring it tonight to the altar and plead the blood over it. Amen. The blood will never lose its power. Amen. It's just as powerful tonight as it was 2,000 years ago. The blood of Jesus Christ, it cleanses us from all sin. It will do for us what nothing else can do. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We need to visit the altar often. Hallelujah. Amen. We can't pray anybody past where we are. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. That's why if you've got the Holy Ghost, you need to be around people praying them through the Holy Ghost. Getting them. Say, we don't have anybody in our church seeking the Holy Ghost. Go out and find them. Witness. I guarantee you there's a sinner to be found in your town. I promise you that. I may have never been to your city, but I just bet you there's a sinner in your town. Amen. Amen. In Jesus' name, stand with me right now. The blood will never lose its power. The blood will never lose its power. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. I read about a man by the name of Malcolm Muggeridge. After World War II, his wife needed a blood transfusion. His wife, whom he loved with all of his heart. And he laid down beside her on a gurney. And they put a needle in his arm and went over to his wife. And as he laid there, he began to see color run up through that line, that IV, and over into his wife. His wife desperately needed a blood transfusion. And Malcolm looked up at the doctor, and he said this to the doctor, Doc, Don't cut yourself short. Get all you need. Take all you need from my wife. Jesus Christ hangs on a cross. And he makes the same declaration to you and I tonight. Don't cut yourself short. Take all you need. I want you to leave this conference at the end of this week with all the blood of Jesus that you need. Don't cut yourself short. Don't think you're going to exhaust heaven. Don't think for a moment that you're going to be greedy and stingy. I'm telling you, there is a supply that never runs dry. Don't try to deal with the small stuff yourself and just take the big stuff to God. I'm telling you, it's all big if it causes me to lose heaven. It's all big. I don't want anything to get in between me and my journey to heaven. And I'm telling you tonight, the blood will never lose its power. Amen. There are countless testimonies of people that have prayed, many of them for years. My mother prayed for my father when I was a child. She was raised in a Pentecostal church and backslid as a teenage girl. At the age of 15, she married my dad, who was 17. Everybody gave them about 6 months to live together. The marriage was over when my dad passed away after 26 years of marriage. Three sons. But when she started having babies, she began to go to church. And I went to church all my life. But as a child, she wanted her husband to be filled with the Holy Ghost. My dad didn't own a tie. He didn't own a suit. He didn't go to funerals. He didn't go to weddings. He never went to church. Had no use for it. I could tell you, I don't take the time right now to tell you, but it's quite a humorous story. But she had to bargain with him to get him to go to church. He was a hunter. And he had his eye on a shotgun. She said, "I'll go buy you that shotgun if you'll go to church with me one time." He didn't trust her. He said, "You go buy the shotgun and I'll go to church with you one time." She went and bought the shotgun. He saw it in the box there. She said, "Oh no, you don't open it till we get back from church." My mother knew that she wouldn't have many opportunities to get him to the house of God. My dad came in and sat on the back row. But she began to plead the blood. Plead the blood. For years before that, every time we would take prayer requests, my mom would raise her hand and say, "Pray for my husband, he's lost. Pray for my husband, he's lost." Every service, she's pleading the blood, pleading the blood, pleading the blood, pleading the blood. That night in that service, singing just an old hymn, "Amazing Grace," something got a hold of his heart. That old coarse sinner who had no time for God found tears flowing out of his eyes uncontrollably. He didn't understand what was happening to him, but he had suddenly become beneficiary of the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. And my mother was not going to let up or let go of him. Hallelujah. That night, he gave his heart to the Lord. About 6 weeks later, he received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. God called him to preach the gospel. Hallelujah. Amen. I don't know if he ever shot the gun. Amen. But he got the Holy Ghost. And when he was 48 years of age, after living most of his adult life full of the Holy Ghost, God called him home. Amen. In 1978, he left this world covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, full of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And because of the blood, He lies in a grave tonight waiting for the trump of God. Hallelujah. Amen. I buried him when I was just a young man, but I buried him with the knowledge that I will see him again, because we have both been beneficiary of the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. I tell you what I feel. If you have a member of your family that's not living for God, and you've got a burden, and I know you have a burden to see them saved, I want you to get out from where you are, begin to make your way down here, pleading the blood, pleading the blood. Amen. See them not as they are, but see them as you want them to be. Full of the Holy Ghost, talking in other tongues, worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. See them as you want them to be in Jesus' name. Look at this move. Amen. There's a revival in Australia of backsliders. There's a revival in Australia of those. It's going to be an easy revival. They're going to know how to come back. Amen. Hallelujah. God's going to reach down and honor your faith. Hallelujah. The devil is a liar. If he's so told you that there can't be saved, you refuse to listen to that. Amen. God said, whosoever will, let him come and drink of the water of life freely. Hallelujah. Amen. Plead the blood. Plead the blood. Plead the blood. Plead the blood.